services, and there are typically no centralised wellbeing service that would otherwise be available in a classic 9-to-5 office setting. How people are paid, career options, length of career, as well as structure, employed, self-employed, or through a limited company. These are all completely different for the sports industry. Very difficult to navigate through all of this, and that's where we come in. As the key sponsor of the IRTPA's National League, I'm available to you to help. If you are interested in learning more, upskilling financially, getting a plan together to be in a better position, please do reach out. Thank you, and looking forward to the Super League in April.
Hello and welcome back to the Queen's Club for the inaugural edition of the FLM Super League. My name is Ben Gatenby and you are watching the second fixture. This is between Fahey's Forces and Shenkman's Henchmen. This is the second pair, the second pop, playing a singles match. And we have the first pair playing next, and the three and fours playing last this evening. So introducing the players for this first fixture, as I am joined in the commentary once again by Alex Hume.
Hello again, Ben. Nice to be back for the second instalment tonight. Should be a good match on this.
So starting with Darren Long, world rank 13. With a court adjustment here of 1.1 points at Queen's. So that is his handicap. Plays 1.1 points better than his handicap whenever he plays at Queen's, which is not too shabby for him. Career highlights that category A Open, or the 0-9s on three occasions, and he'll be a strong favourite for that in a couple of weeks up in Manchester.
On his home court.
On his home court, exactly. And then US Open round of 16 lost to Nick Howell. Getting closer to dethroning him because he played a five-setter against him at the British Open at the same stage, but couldn't get the better of him in either occasion. His opponent tonight is ladies world ranked number one, Claire Fahey. And what can we say about Claire's career? She's been ladies world champion since 2011. Made the Open quarterfinal. Open draw at the Australian Open this year. The the furthest she's gone through an open draw in the singles. Also made the semi-final in the doubles. Her recent matches not on here is her results from the British Open last week, which she won for, I believe it was the 12th time. She went down to Australia to play the Australian Ladies Open down in Hobart quite recently as well. And then the head-to-head match, three apiece. Fairly evenly shared between these two, with matches going back well over a decade. So Alex, how do you see this one shaping up?
Well, Darren's probably the narrow favourite given the current form, but Claire will definitely give him a good run here. I expect this to be pretty close again. Darren obviously a big target hit. He loves finding the grill from anywhere on the court. Claire will be hoping she can use her fantastic retrieving skills and heading to length to good effect. Particularly with these new balls we've been talking about, getting a bit more perch off the back walls. So yeah, it could be a good battle.
Absolutely. And with Darren once again supporting his bright green neon shoes. We saw Bryn earlier with his bright pink shoes.
Yeah, all colours of the rainbow today. Zach was sporting some fluorescent numbers as well.
I wonder if there wasn't the white clothing policy, just how zen some of these players' outfits would get.
Oh, there are some good fashionistas amongst the pros, top players. I think Vaughan Hamilton would come out in something pretty out there.
So marker today will be Levi Gale. Darren, to get us underway in this Henchmen versus Forces fixture.
Since 2015, so their games may not have changed massively, but still be a different test for them, I suppose.
So Claire has a big month of tennis lined up. She played the British Ladies Open on the weekend down at Seacourt. Then in addition to playing this tournament on Saturday, she'll be playing in the Ladies Open doubles rackets, which if the Forces make the final of this tournament, she'll be playing both on the same day. She will be playing in the Ladies Rackets World Championship at the start of May. So the format for that event, the Leia is the defending champion, so she awaits a challenger. The top four ladies will challenge. That is Claire Fay, Georgie Willis, Tara Lumley, and Cheska Sweet. So they will play a series of elimination matches to work out who will challenge Leia for that title. So on the handicap, there's a difference of about 3 or 4 points between these two, which would be equate to a difference of about 0.15 love. This particular pot two, probably has the widest gap between on handicap between the number one in the pot and the number four in the pot. On this pot three, I think the total gap between number one and four is about 0.4 on handicap. It was interesting doing the player draft this year, all on the live stream, having players, the captains, call in from wherever they were in the world. Shenkman was down in Australia at the time for the Bathurst Cup. I think for a first attempt at it, I think it worked pretty well.
Bryn was in a taxi, it seemed.
Yeah, so the players were asked, what is the best time on this particular day which suits all of you? And so he had plenty of notice, but...
Speak of the devil, being joined by the chap we just said was in Australia for the draft. Rob Shenkman coming into the commentator's booth.
Yeah, I just thought there was a change of end, so I thought I'd dip in the headphones. Great start from Darren. Sort of style of play I'm accustomed to seeing on a day-to-day basis in Manchester. You can have real issues if you can't get in behind that main wall, so... Yeah, he's been red hot so far. Don't know what you think, Alex, but pretty hot on that dead-on count.
Yeah, trying to force the issue, quite literally.
And it just shows you, really, if you've got that easy winner in your locker, like let's say even when the missed force low is producing a racket error, you're going to have to work extremely hard from the service end to build up that 4 points and win the game. So probably why Darren is a 2-love, 30-love up.
Yeah, those shots do often, ones that go low, do often shoot out low, so they're not easy to pick up. Get any purchase. That's fantastic shot. There they go. Cool.
Oh, I thought Claire would go high back wall. Sorry, mate.
Jamie Douglas says.
He's good at that. Great read from Darren. That's three love. Grill. Wow.
Yeah, well, that was there. I just was reading that with the main ball, but difficult spin.
Reserve. Darren likes to use that main wall on his defensive volley. Obviously, such a big target if you're not 100% confident of getting the full face on the ball. So, Claire gets to chase the line.
Yeah, and control the length a bit better there. More margin for error in terms of not hitting it off the back pen now, because that main wall will take some of the pace off the ball.
And also it's just another angle, isn't it? Just a bit more spin, I think, in this game.
Yeah.
If you can just add that extra degree of difficulty, yeah, you're going to get results. So I favour it myself. Maybe you'll see it in about 25-30 minutes.
Looking forward to it. Yeah. How are you feeling about ahead of that encounter?
Just got nothing to lose, really. Had a good rest from Saturday, so body feeling good. Banging ibuprofen down before the match, and hope you're ready to pick some balls out the dead on.
Rob mentioning Saturday there, that's his goal racking match against Jamie Douglas at MCC. He came from two sets behind to take eventually the fifth. Battle of boasts and wills and all sorts there that game. Battle of the LucasAids at change of ends, probably as well.
Yeah, there you go. Battle of bananas.
Yeah. Not like that.
Lost it. I don't want it. It's a. Joined up in the top gallery by Lewis Williams now, so he's also a forcer, a Fahey forcer. Claire struggling with the pace of this game, I think, at the moment.
Yeah, obviously, this format being.
Oh, wow. Oh.
Yeah, that's another class. Mabel, volley from Darren, taking quite high.
Right, I think we're going to do a warm up, but mate, I'll catch you in a bit. Hopefully, join you up here for the doubles.
Indeed, see you later on. Yeah, Claire, probably just struggling with the pace down shot at the moment. And obviously, with this format, best of nine, first of nine, one set. Don't reset after six. First to six, as you would normally in tennis matches, for a new set, so especially important to get ahead. What's Darren's doing?
What do you think Claire's got to do to change the outcome here?
I think mixing it up a bit with the pace of shots and finding good length. Most she's probably giving Darren one or two easy balls
okay.
in each rally. I think she gets the length right. These balls are cutting down nicely off the back wall, so they will put the players under pressure. Not that they won't get them up necessarily, but they'll put them under a bit more pressure.
Yeah. and then gives her a chance to maybe hit an opening
exactly.
Or okay,
exactly.
Finish
she
the point.
She has absolutely got buckets of power, she needs it.
Good.
Last gallery chase hit. That's a good break from Claire. Not trying to force issue too much. Just playing honest shot back.
And has she been serving this sort of underarm twist the whole time so far, or is this a recent addition?
No, both players seem to be doing that. Occasionally it's not the railroad.
Yeah, no, Darren often favours the railroad.
Again, time it. Claire's aid.
She's on the scoreboard, here we go then. I think with Darren, even more so than other players, really got to keep the serve off the back wall.
Yeah.
Very attacking off that first ball.
Yeah.
So there's a fair amount of disparity between his back wall shots and his volley, for instance, his
right.
back wall is very, very, very good, and his, I'd say his volley is not good, but relative to his back wall is a drop down, I would say.
Well, he has managed to find quite a few main wall deadhams on that volley already, so maybe Claire had that in mind, but wasn't able to get much joy out so far, but there
you
go.
That there is, you know, Darren, bread and butter. Slightly overhit serve, not a bad serve, but only slightly just reaching the back wall.
Queen's up is notoriously a tough call, so keep the ball tight.
It's a good volley from Claire.
They're getting a foothold again in this game. I know she's 35-15 down now, but
she's
keeps this end.
Oh, that's just crept out of court.
Say that. Already chase.
Yeah, she was a bit unlucky that rally, ended up hitting the bando above the grill to go out for a hazard. See what Darren says here, presumably a railroad on the hazard.
Probably, often a favourite tactic.
Question for you, Alex, what's your views on the high back wall shot to beat a hazard? Running out to it goes into the net,
yes.
Are you a fan of that?
I've seen the opinions from the pros. I think if it's in the rules, you play for it and it takes a little bit less skill, perhaps, to execute than other shots, but I think it's a...
You're a fan?
Well, I don't mind it, because it's in the gold racket game, referencing Rob Shenkman versus Jamie Douglas on the weekend.
Uh-huh.
Rob started getting wise to that, and Jamie likes to use that as a tactic and actually get up the court to try and catch the ball before it reached the net.
Yep.
Jamie's trying to beat a hazard chase, and actually he was fantastic getting up there. And you know, Jamie's one of the hardest hitters in the game probably, and it made for a very entertaining rally if he caught it on the volley as he often did. Nice.
Well read from Claire there.
Claire's get a good short chase. Since you asked the question, what are your thoughts on it?
It's not a shot I've ever played, actually.
Really?
No, it's just contrary
just
to...
Just feels a bit...
I don't know, I don't enjoy... I just think it's a bit cheap. You know, I'd put it in the sort of boomerang category. It's sort of, you know, like you say, it's not against the rules, but it just doesn't feel quite right. I don't feel good about it.
No.
Yeah.
Rather win.
Whereas I think you've got a lot of other options as well. I don't think you need to do it really.
You've got to be.
You can
pretty,
find a dead one, roll a near, get a gallon. You know, feels a little bit desperate, a little bit cheap for me. But what do I know?
No, well, I'm sure you're not alone.
Right then.
Pros were asked, weren't they? What their one rule change would be?
I think a few people might have answered that one. Yeah. That was when we were in the French Open, so there was a bit of talk about the pass rule, and talks about taking optional lets on serves that currently fault. So a few things like that were thrown around.
Like in rackets, you can take the option of hitting a serve that is out technically
Okay.
to try and get a foothold rally.
Phil Clare needs to see what he can do to get this game 6-1. Quite a tough deficit to overcome.
So it's
2-5 all of a sudden.
This format, just a reminder, is not standard sets of tennis here. It's one set to nine. So
what a good rest. Lovely rest. Great backhand defence on Clare.
Yeah.
Finally in front of the grill to hit a winner.
So even if Darren does manage to win this game, we won't reset to level for a second set.
Oh, he's done it again. You're right, that volley.
He's been practicing.
Volley, main all dead on.
Shanks has obviously been feeding that in their practice hits as they've been having some.
She's still going with that same serve.
Yeah. Interestingly, the doubles that preceded this match, Vaughan particularly was having good success with the bobble. These balls sliding down the back wall a little bit. There you go. Just catching the edge. Like that.
Another question for you then, Alex. You've obviously been on the IRP scheme doing some marking tests and improving your skills.
Yeah.
Here at Queen's, I don't know if the camera picks it up, but there's a cable hanging down below the out court line. So it's sort of touching the out court plane and hangs down into the court. What's the actual rule if it hits that?
Well, it was caught in the last match.
Don't think you can see. I've marked here today. You can't see it from the marker's chair.
I would say it's in.
In play.
Yeah. Am I right?
I think the official rule is if it's touching the out of court line, it's deemed as out of court. So if it touches the cable that is also touching out of court, then it's deemed as out of court. But I think you would tend to clarify that before the match. And I think in the instance you're talking about. I think it was Vaughan Hamilton that serves, and he then hit the grill into the winning gallery anyway. So, point was over in any case. But I think that would be the rule.
Interesting.
So slightly unusual one.
Yeah, that is a quirky one.
I'm sure they'll get that cable fixed in no time.
If there aren't enough quirky rules in this game,
exactly.
Just add one more. Yeah.
Here we go, and there's that backhand grill from Clare in the replay. Volley from Darren. Very well played. Running away with it at the moment, isn't he?
Dan's trying to get us back on schedule.
He is. Rapid play.
Well, we're pretty tight.
Pick up.
Yeah, that was good tennis there, just for both of them.
Just feeling like Dan is just not making those errors at the moment. He just keeps getting one more shot back. And a lovely railroad again.
Yeah, he's rattling through here.
7-1. Quick serving a little bit here.
Yeah.
I think he knows he's got momentum, keen to use it to full advantage.
Good shot.
Good pace on Clare there. We'll do something to change the tide. Is that coach in the
Hazard
galleries? Maybe suggesting some change of tactics, I don't know.
Again.
Yes. Very, very good target hitters, Darren Long.
Moving so fast to the scoreboard. We can't keep up with the stream. I think it's 7.
Turn from Clare there.
Yeah.
Hit nice forehand force again, straight at the body.
Sit up a bit, try and get some shots lengthening. Getting an opportunity to force when she ball opens up.
Yeah, have a bit of success with that straight force now. 4-15 to Clare. 3 points on the bounce there. Out of court, just like that.
Good pick up from Darren, but
put under it.
That's a tidy game from Clare.
2-7.
I think
the stream's a little bit behind, but 2-7 I believe.
Yeah.
Interestingly, winning a lot of those points in the receiver's end there.
That's good.
So it's the play, a little change there.
Often that follow-up shot after a good bit of defence can turn the rally, but she hit a good shot there into the backhand corner.
Time to chase.
She'll probably take that in a minute. See the other
one? Yeah, I think as long as it's below the bando, she'll be quite happy there. pretty tight one there. Only six chases laid by each player. That feels like not very many.
No.
Not much changing ends going on.
Only quite short rallies, actually. The majority of the matches we've seen so far today. Claire read the boast.
She did, a bit of squash going on there. I don't know if it's a concentration thing, but you know, Darren seems to be making a couple of errors here.
Yeah.
It seemed pretty flawless in the first half of what I was watching.
Yeah, actually.
Claire getting a little bit of momentum.
Taking a moment there, I think, to regather his thoughts. Claire showing how much it means getting points to the board. A little fist bump there after that last point.
Very good play.
Great.
Bit of disguise there as well. I don't know about you, but it looked like she was lining up to play into the backhand, and then at the last minute sent it down the line. Darren going slightly the wrong way.
Yeah.
Reaching it, but not enough time to get it back over.
She's definitely got her footwork going as well. She backtracked there off that time, but very well. Tough to do, actually.
These shorter formats, sometimes it's, you know, getting a good warm-up in is vital, and if you're not quite there, not quite warm, got quite used to the court, the first few games can run away from you.
How would you approach warm-up a bit differently in a match like this, one set to nine? It's a bit of a sprint, and you don't reset again after six games.
Yeah, maybe do a slightly longer warm-up, really. So, it's, you know, I'm not in a best-of-five-set match, you're not going to be doing, you know, a huge long warm-up where you're going to be, you know, you come the three and a half hours later, you're going to be exhausted.
First two sets are
well, and whereas, you know, something like this, you need to be able to come out feeling warm and, you know, good to go and muscles loose. And probably a slightly longer warm-up might be a sensible approach.
Probably try and ramp it up a little bit, mimic a bit of gameplay even.
Yeah, you know, a little bit of footwork.
Try and get everything out of the corners.
Yeah, that's right.
So, a yard worse chase here. Just to go 3-7 behind, but starting to call back games.
That post.
Picked it.
Vintage down along that one.
Chase.
Claire sort of picked it as well, she was nearly there.
Yeah,
but he kept it very short, it was only just going to beat the chase. So. Oh, well ducked.
You should do well to avoid that coming off the underside of the band there.
And again, Darren going for the main ball once again.
Yeah.
He's not missed many, but that one just hitting the underside of the band, though, popping out for a chase.
Doesn't count as a shot on target.
Is this a replay of it? Let's have a little look.
Yeah.
Look at that.
Very good action.
Popped over. What a cameraman.
Gated Beak will be proud of that one.
Makes up for the commentary anyway.
Not his commentary. Hasten to her.
There we go.
Yeah. Hold on, Claire. Good hustle.
Very good. Right then. Can she keep that momentum going? Let's see.
Yeah, when Darren was on that run of games, he wouldn't have missed a railroad like that, would he? Definitely upset his momentum a bit. Small things, but
it's a good pick up. Showing that chase. A little fist bump there, she's bang up for, isn't she?
Absolutely. That was
what we like to see, particularly since I'm on her team. That's what we like to see, brilliant. Ooh, what's unlucky, full stretch there.
Might have been heading over the goal. Tough to tell.
Interestingly, just saw the stats there that Claire's actually served more points than Darren so far in this match.
Feel like that, does it?
Yeah, it's often we talk about the value of the service end, don't we? And, you know, when we're coaching players. And I do think there's something to be said for the lower down the handicap ranges you get, the more even that spread is. So
the better players.
Yeah, so if you look at your, you know, your newer players, high handicap players in your sort of 60 to 90 handicap range, that, you know, they're winning a lot of points at the service end and far fewer at the receiver's end.
Yeah.
whereas as you get down into teens and single figures and, you know, plus handicaps, it tends to even out a lot more. Yeah. Some players that are more attacking can win quite a few points from the receiver's end.
Yeah, certainly look at someone like Rob Fahey when he was getting towards the tail end of his career. He probably was quite happy being at the receiver's end, thinking he could force his way out of trouble.
Absolutely, you know, you're not really beating him with serves.
Yeah, he knew he wasn't going to, when he was playing Camden, for instance, he knew he wasn't going to out-retrieve him, probably.
Yeah, I think at that stage in his career, definitely he'd be quite happy. You look at that, the world championship here, hitting main wall after main wall to win games and ultimately the championship back.
And at Preston in 2022, we got 5 sets off Camden.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Right then, where are we here?
Darren's still religiously going for that main wall devil though.
Yeah, it's just clear. I think she's going to find a little bit shorter on that serve so it doesn't reach the back wall.
Trust her retrieving. Yeah, she keeps just nicking the penthouse on those serves. I don't think she's meaning to.
Yeah, I suspect that was a nicer line. I think that was going to be short enough, like you say, if it just clipped the side wall first.
Yeah.
And there we are again, another main wall.
What's your serving tactic here, famous serving tactic?
My serving tactic at Queens?
Yeah, Queens.
Oh, I've still got matches to play, Alex. I couldn't dare give that away.
Just in case anyone was listening.
No, I think it's quite dependent on the opponent.
Yeah.
Singles, doubles. There's a few different things that have worked for me over the years, quite an array. Depends how new the balls are, you know, all these sorts of things you've got to take into account.
Oh, that's fantastic. Fantastic defence initially from Darren. A couple of fantastic retreats.
Claire just staying in here.
And Claire did well to reach behind her to boast that one out.
Oh, that's such a good cut volley. Really lent on that one.
It's exactly the serve that Claire has been wanting to do with this end.
Yeah.
Have the sidewall first to shoot down the penthouse. She beat it well.
She disguised it.
It's exactly the sort of shot that 3-7 down. Feels like the right shot to try and do. That's it.
It's good width. Another one's. Bet your mortgage on Darren Long. Hitting the girl from there.
The girl doesn't move. Darren Long, 2024.
Just hit that little nick of the sidewall there and pop back into the middle. We find ourselves at 8-3. Darren Train's going again. Oh, that's a good cut. Stayed very low.
Yeah. They've been doing that a fair bit, as well say, but that was a good shot. Penning cut on. Claire.
Oh no. A little bit fortunate from Darren there, but great defensive volley.
It was.
Did well to get it back.
Apologises. That's a good base.
Good get.
So, who have you got later today, Lewis?
For the crowd at home, the next match we've got is the team captain, so Rob Fahey versus Rob Shenkman. And then the last match of the day is myself and Bertie Vallat for Fahey's Forces against Nino Marola and Will Flynn for Shenkman's Henchmen. Should be good fun. I've never played a doubles with Bertie before, so that'd be good. I'm not sure Will and Nino have played together either. So there's some interesting matchups in the doubles in this. You know, this format's just meant that, you know, a few people that don't necessarily play team up normally. Find themselves together, which is good for the viewers. Good serve from Claire there. Better that one, wasn't it?
Yeah. It's all about the length, particularly here at Queens. Margins for a small. Now half a yard. Surely.
Good cart.
Yeah. Here we go. Match point.
Good defence. Oh, wowzers.
What a way to finish it.
Better than a shooter.
Darren takes.
Very impressive.
Match 9-3. Very quick time.
And with that, find himself as the current MVP.
Yeah.
Before that, we had four players tied. Yes. MVP with it all with 9-7 victories.
Yeah.
But now, on game difference, Darren's taken it on day one so far.
Indeed.
We'll see how the next one goes. Rob Fahey, Rob Shenkman coming up very shortly.
Battle of the Robs.
Indeed. Good. Well, thanks for that.
Thank you, Lewis.
You can find the match summary on the screen. Thanks to Ben Gatorbit for the streaming. And we'll see you all tuning in for the next one, I'm sure.
Indeed. See you shortly.
FLM are proudly sponsoring the National League, and we are really looking forward to the Super League in England, which is taking place over 4 days. This short and sweet video is simply an introduction to what we do and how we do it. Specifically, how we help people sponsor online. So what is it that we actually do? Well, we help people be in the best possible financial position they can be. Specifically, we ensure that clients achieve their goals and aspirations through holistic and quality financial planning. We work with people long term to build a plan and, importantly, stick to it. We also ensure to educate and improve understanding of the broader financial world to those who don't work in the industry. When it comes to understanding and education on finance, we feel the sports industry specifically is somewhat overlooked, where people less possible conversations on finances and a typically no centralised wellbeing service that would otherwise be available in the classic 9-to-5 office setting. How people are paid, career options, length of career, as well as structure, employed, self-employed or through a limited company. These are all completely different for the sports industry. Very difficult to navigate through all of this, and that's where we come in. As the key sponsor of the IRTPA's National League, I'm available to you to help. If you are interested in learning more, upskilling financially, and getting a plan together to be in a better position, please do reach out. Thank you, and looking forward to the Super League in April. Hello, my name is Sam Candy and I'm the advisor at FLM. FLM are proudly sponsoring the National League and we are really looking forward to the Super League in April, which is taking place over 4 days at Queen's Club. This short and sweet video is simply an introduction to what we do and how we do it. Specifically, how we help people in sport. So what is it that we actually do? Well, we help people be in the best possible financial position they can be. Specifically, we ensure that clients achieve their goals and aspirations through holistic and quality financial planning. We work with people long term to build a plan and, importantly, stick to it. We also ensure to educate and improve understanding of the broader financial world to those who don't work in the industry. When it comes to understanding and education on finance, we feel the sport industry specifically is somewhat overlooked, where people have less possibly conversations on finances, and there are typically no centralised wellbeing service that would otherwise be available in a classic 9-to-5 office setting. How people are paid, career options, length of career, as well as structure, employed, self-employed, or through a limited company. These are all completely different for the sports industry. Very difficult to navigate through all of this, and that's where we come in. As the key sponsor of the IRTPA's National League, I'm available to you to help. If you are interested in learning more, upskilling financially, and getting a plan together to be in a better position, please do reach out. Thank you, and looking forward to the Super League in April. Hello, my name is Sam Candy and I'm the visor at FLM. FLM are proudly sponsoring the National League and we are really looking forward to the Super League in April, which is taking place over 4 days at Queen's Club. This short and sweet video is simply an introduction to what we do and how we do it. Specifically, how we help people in sport. So what is it that we actually do? Well, we help people be in the best possible financial position they can be. Specifically, we ensure that clients achieve their goals and aspirations through holistic and quality financial planning. We work for people long term to build a plan and, importantly, stick to it. We also ensure to educate and improve understanding of the broader financial world to those who don't work in the industry. When it comes to understanding and education on finance, we feel the sport industry specifically is somewhat overlooked, where people have less possibly conversations on finances, and there are typically no centralised wellbeing service that would otherwise be available in a classic 9-to-5 office setting. How people are paid, career options, length of career, as well as structure, employed, self-employed, or through a limited company. These are all completely different for the sports industry. Very difficult to navigate through all of this, and that's where we come in. As the key sponsor of the IRTPA's National League, I'm available to you to help. If you are interested in learning more, upskilling financially, and getting a plan together to be in a better position, please do reach out. Thank you, and looking forward to the Super League in April. Hello, my name is Sam Candy and I'm the visor at FLM. FLM are proudly sponsoring the National League and we are really looking forward to the Super League in April, which is taking place over 4 days at Queen's Club. This short and sweet video is simply an introduction to what we do and how we do it. Specifically, how we help people in sport. So what is it that we actually do? Well, we help people be in the best possible financial position they can be. Specifically, we ensure that clients achieve their goals and aspirations through holistic and quality financial planning. We work with people long term to build a plan and importantly, stick to it. We also ensure to educate and improve understanding of the broader financial world to those who don't work in the industry. When it comes to understanding and education on finance, we feel the sport industry specifically is somewhat overlooked, where people have less possibly conversations on finances and there are typically no centralised wellbeing service that would otherwise be available in a classic 9-to-5 office setting. How people are paid, career options, length of career, as well as structure, employed, self-employed or through a limited company. These are all completely different for the sports industry. Very difficult to navigate through all of this, and that's where we come in. As the key sponsor of the IRTPA's National League, I'm available to you to help. If you are interested in learning more, upskilling financially, getting a plan together to be in a better position, please do reach out. Thank you, and looking forward to the Super League in April.
FLM Super League event where we've got team captains Rob Fahey and Rob Shenkman for their respective teams. Fahey forces and Shenkman's henchmen. That's difficult to say after a few lemonades, isn't it, Vaughan?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Or even before a few lemonades in this case.
What's your predictions here then, Alex?
Well, these two met in the US Open recently. Rob Fahey coming out of retirement, sent over by Claire to get a good paycheck after crashing out the doubles early. Rob Fahey managed to win in three sets there, but was pushed in the first set by Shenkman. That went 6-5 Fahey's way, but was 40-love up there. 5-all, so had an opportunity to win this first set. Could have been a bit of a momentum swing. It's difficult to look past the
class,
the greatest,
yeah,
of all time, though. Whenever he steps on court, we'll probably be saying that when he's about 104. What do you think, Paul?
Well, first to one set is definitely a factor.
Who do you think that helps more?
Well, I suppose both ways you've looked at it. Both come out strong and they can kind of, yeah, they don't need to save energy. Yeah, Shenkman could easily start, get a good start, and then see where that takes him.
Yeah, absolutely. Maybe, you know, maybe it plays into Rob Fahey's hands slightly more, because it's not exactly, it's not going to be a best of five set of marathon.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Shenkman had one of those on the weekend. The MCC gold racket, beating Jamie Douglas eventually. 3-2 in sets, coming from two sets behind. And Jamie's.
You understand this court adjustment? That's new to me.
Yes, I think it means that Rob. It's
that
something
a handicap
to do with
adjustment?
Rob's, yeah. Rob Fahey there, for instance, plays 0.3 worse.
Worse, so a minus 8.9 plus.
I'll be corrected by Ben Gatesley if I'm wrong, I'm sure, but I think that's what it means.
Yeah,
which is
interesting,
given the number of...
It was, yeah.
Given the 2018 World Championship.
Well, the number's normalised, so he's probably got a higher score elsewhere. So it just means, because his handicap will... it would be based on, you know, an average of the kind of courts he plays on a lot. But in general, for the top guys, you will see that number be fairly small, just because they're so used to picking up new courts. So relative to his handicap, he doesn't perform better or worse in many places.
Yeah. Obviously, a lot of events do happen here at Queen's in the calendar. Not a bad resume. Just a few wins here and there.
Almost ran out of space.
Yeah, that is as good a resume as you will ever see.
Pretty incredible.
Multiple world champion, including that pretty win here in 2018 after Cam. It's taken it off him in 2016, across the pond. There you go, you see Rob's recent matches at the US Open of Philadelphia. So he beat Rob Shenkman. And then Tony Matthews succumbed to John Lumley, who drove Cam all the way to five sets in the final. But again, lost to the current world champion. Head to head, these two haven't played that much, but Fahey's come out on top both times.
Setting there from Shenkman, 3-6.
Yeah.
Can he repeat
that
it?
Just after the World Championship at your court hall.
Yeah. Obviously wasn't there at that point, but...
Played host a fantastic World Championship, though. Breasted that year. I went for a couple of days. Took the old man along for his 80th birthday.
Love it.
Couldn't get enough of it.
What a cauldron.
It was, with Claire banging on the penthouse roof every point. It was brilliant. So it looks like Fahey will be serving first in this match. Be interesting to see if these two change up their tactics to a normal sort of open match, given that it's one set first in nine games.
I believe Zach Eder was the marker for this one today.
Hear the dulcet northern tones. Here we go. Just range on those Nice serves. Good defence.
Controlling these rallies early on.
What a read.
Knows where his off stump is, and that's out of court there from Rob Fahey. Receiving end. Rob looking for that change of tactic down the line. Not quite coming off. So Vaughan, what's up next for you in your world tennis calendar?
Next for me will be, still got the end of Div 3 National League to finish off. Yet one more this Sunday. And then it will be over to Manchester in a couple of weeks for the Cat A.
Who have you got first up there?
I got Henry Henchmen. Which will be.
That will be a tasty one.
Yeah, currently 2-1 to him.
Oh, is it? A head to head?
It is.
Where did
neutral
you, where
court
you
will
met?
Be.
Well,
we met last week at Prestead, so twice in a month.
You took that one?
I took it, home court, helped out.
Impressive, because Henry's probably one of the fastest improving players at the moment.
Yes, definitely.
In the world.
And the first game goes to Shenkman.
Fahey just redesigned the court a little bit there. Gets his reward. That's a brilliant defence.
Great rally
from the Mancunian. Shortest
place
you'll ever see.
Was it worth it?
Hazard chase does always give the receiver the option of heading into the galleries at will, so
extra few galleries.
He'll take it. First up. Yeah, good tactic there from Shenkman, trying to get Rob Fahey right into that forehand corner off of Railroad. Yes, nice mix up. Wins the point, does Shenkman. Go 2 love up here. Shenkman responds to take a 2-love lead early on here. Very well to get that up. That one rolls out already.
Down the service end.
Yeah. It's an interesting fast start here from Shenkman, putting a lot of pressure on Rob, getting moving.
Yeah, I think he's dealing with Rob's serves quite well at the moment. See if that changes.
Yeah. It's obviously a tough, you mentioned before, it's tough, it is a tough court to serve on.
Yeah, it is.
Not much stays tight.
No.
Rob Shenkman's classic. Sort of underarm, twisty drag.
A lot of high serves in the Bryn Ben match earlier.
Yeah.
I wonder if those will come into play a bit later on today. Maybe here we go.
Rob might have heard you there.
Oh, he's listening.
Good high to that one. Yeah, a bit tame on the return there from Fahey. Some raucous support in the gallery here from the team captain. For the team captain, down long. You will find that listening into matches of Rob Shenkman, he will sort of give quite detailed descriptions of what he should and should be doing if he misses a shot.
40-15 to Fahey.
Go on the board. Yeah, Rob. Fahey's starting to mix it up a bit now. Good turn of serve. Oh, he's judging the length. Probably had a bit more time on that backhand there than he thought. Try and post.
That's a great finish from Shenkman there.
Finds his first winning gallery in the match. Such a persistent rather timbre hitter is Shenkman, just changing up there. Have you played either of these two, Vaughan?
I've played Shenkman in the Jesmond Dean Cup last year. Never Rob Fahey. A few leagues above.
Like facing Shenkman at the other end. What do you watch out for?
He's just such a worker, isn't he? He's going to get a lot of balls back,
yeah,
and then puts away his chances when he needs to, but staying in rallies is his game.
Yes, if ever there was a grinder on court in terms of
definitely
making your opponent work every point of the match. It's the second one we've seen recently that's come down from a height onto the edge of those galleries. for Shenkman. Got a good replay there down the line of Shankman's grill hitting. Bit of a crucial game this for Rob Fahey to get back on parity. That'll help. Out of court. Gives him a 40-30 lead. Full dead on down below to watch this blockbuster match.
It's the big one.
Yeah, that's a good shot from Shenkman. Damn, it's that backhand corner. Tricky today. Ball's been pretty lively, so it'll cut down off the back wall. He's over hit that one.
Long.
Not often you see Rob Fahey overhit a shot down the line to the grill. But he got away with it.
Back to juice.
How does Rob finish this point? Like that. Persistent pressure really on Rob Fahey there to finish the point.
Great retrieval, good exchange there.
There's one man you wanted to remain calm in those situations. The grill off the sidewall behind the timber there. Comes out for a hazard. Interestingly, on the Robin Clare's rackets, as you may have seen in the match before, Clare versus Darren, I think they've got a monogram of some sort on their rackets, which looks quite unique. I can't work it out.
I think it's CF. Quite a few of those lying around at Prested.
Okay. Presumably Claire's initials.
Yes, I'm presuming so, yeah.
I think you deserve that one, yeah. Ladies World Champion, as long as she's been.
Oh. Somewhat awkward bounce, but he's dealt with it well.
Bit of a stick from his teammates up here in the gallery for that one, but he negotiated well enough, and that's a good bobble.
Good to see the dead on nice and full.
This for Rob. Once you get your nose in front, particularly in this format.
Yeah, it's always going to be chasing. No,
it's tough.
No extra set to restart. That's a great finish again.
There we go.
Two girls in a row.
That's a very good shot. That's tough ball to do that to.
Just absorb that pressure.
It makes it look a bit easier than it is on the street. Saw in the couple of players match in the previous fixture between Ben Ted Matthews and Bryn Sayers. Ben opened up a three-love lead,
I think it was, yeah.
Twice, and eventually it paid off. Moving out to be a 9-7 winner in that one.
Yeah.
Not far off.
Another fortunate one, but
yeah, we've had a few of those today.
Rob,
Fahey moving into arts. We just see Shenkman reaching forward for that one. I don't think he'd have done the same footwork if he'd had that shot again. Smart himself. So Rob Shenkman fired, just can't see that ball a little bit, seemed to keep it a bit low. It was a cracking shot. That's a fantastic effort. Rob Shenkman, he holds his racket up in apology to Rob Fahey.
Happy to see that said in last gallery.
But you do make your own luck.
Gives Rob the chance. And that's Rob's first grill of the day.
And there's
seems to have found his form now. He's remembered where the targets are.
His first winning gallery of the day. Feel the pressure dial ramping up slightly on Shenkman here. He's just missing one or two, either high or low, because he knows that Rob Fahey, more often than not, is going to be able to kill points. This is good defence so far.
Some great gets there. Easy to put the balls away though.
No.
That's his job. Not too happy with that one.
Well, Fahey complimenting Rob Shenkman there with the quality of that final shot in the rally. Good humour. A reminder, we've got one more match tonight. The doubles between these two teams follows this.
Lewis Williams, Bertie Vallat.
Yep.
Versus Will Flynn.
Nino.
And Nino.
Yeah.
Yeah, Yeah, should be another great game.
That'll be. The Bulls will take another battering in that one. Great, back on volley there. Shanks. Change up there. Fahey. Shenkman was a very good retriever, but he. It's another point of contact. A different point of. Rob Fahey raises his head to the helmet as he. Shoots that one past the right hand post.
Very well played, that.
Very well played from Shanks at the serving end.
Brings up his fifth grill.
Girl count is always pretty high. That's number six.
Number one. Critical at this level to put those balls away.
Yeah. Even at the service end, along with the balls in play, against someone of Faye's quality. Will be even from the receiving end to exert too much pressure. Shanks, some more advice.
Just stand there and volley it.
Tough one, it's coming that quickly there.
Service end is clearly important still.
Yeah. Doesn't matter what level you play. Yeah, great shot. Low into the tab there. How did you feel your doubles went against the two guys earlier, Zach and Max?
Yeah, it was a good game, enjoyed it.
Yeah.
First time playing with Lewis. He was the big hitter, and I tried to take the role of being a little bit more tame. But
ran around to it, yeah.
Yeah, scurried around the back. Seemed to work.
Yeah, it was impressive to watch. What were your tactics in that game? How were you trying to go about it?
Avoid them forcing as much as we could, really, get down that service end as well. Although Gordo's still a good weapon down the receiving end with his forcing. Yeah, it wasn't much in it.
No. Very tight.
And the Matthews Mavericks go 2-1 up. This is obviously a must win for Faye's forces. Currently 1-0 down in the tie. Down long.
That sort of stuff will help though. Great play from Fahey, finding Mabel Tanner there. That's what pressure does though. Obviously ordinarily wouldn't miss that shot, but who knows how good it has to be to get past. Even 55.
Well dodged.
Well marked from Shanks at the other end. Self-marked. See not many chases there, just 5 and 7 between these two so far. It's a little bit about trying to hit through each other as they are in this round. Oh, it's very good defence.
Yeah, 3 or 4. Takes his opportunity very well.
Backhand volleys in a row there from Shenkman. He had to be on the money with every single one of them.
Definitely leading the target count.
Yeah,
maybe that's the difference so far.
He'll take the chase there. See that backhand volley to Tama just looping down to the devil. Slight misread from Rockfay. There it is. So 4-3 up for Shenkman. Yeah, obviously these two are both top players in their own right, but I don't know how many people would have expected this so far.
No, yeah. Expected Shinks to come out quite quick.
Yeah. If he's going to win it, there's no way he can expect
can't
to go
get down
behind.
To start, no.
One way of winning has a chase pretty easily.
It's a bit too easy.
That low full serve net. Nope,
and
loses
the chase.
Second instead of last. Yeah, those bobbles are not easy for the receivers.
Easy off this roof.
Yeah, quite a few players finding that today.
Yeah, getting lucky in our game with that as well.
Yeah, the point was made definitely during your game that towards the business end of your match, you were finding good length of those.
Yeah, a few good bobbles, a few extra bounces.
Because look at someone like Camden Bouvier, he uses the bobble a lot as a first serve.
Yeah. Yeah, which I think people don't use it enough.
Great hitting there.
Just another grill.
Another grill. What are you trying to, when you go for the bobble, it looks a simple enough serve, but there must be thought behind it as to what you're trying to do with it in terms of the length and the height, the trajectory. There's so many variables. What were you trying to do with it in your match?
Yeah, I would definitely kind of find your length on each court and then just keep that same spot, same height, same spot. The kind of bobbling effect was working well today,
exactly.
Getting those kind of hops rolling. Definitely don't want it rolling. That's easy to then volley. So yeah, the roof kind of lends to that.
True. You don't want it rolling, but sometimes these balls aren't always spherical.
No.
In this game. But these ones
that can help
sure,
you.
Sure are. Wouldn't discredit the Queen's Club balls. Finding good width again with that main ball.
Game ball to go 5-3.
Shanks trying to cannon another one into the.
Yeah, he's playing very aggressive.
Into the denim. Yeah, well,
he has to.
Yeah. It's working so far.
Yeah. Probably not normally his. I don't know, maybe not his preferred game style. It's normally more the retriever, but.
He is. I think when he has opportunity, he does.
Oh, he definitely does, yeah.
Tries to do little togs both ends, but he is also very good on the floor.
Probably doesn't mind either.
Prides himself on his fitness.
Great gets.
Yeah,
And it does the job. That is 5-3.
This feels like quite a crucial game. Now, obviously, this is first to nine game set format, so Rob Shenkman isn't one game away from the set. Still plenty of tennis to go.
Volleying extremely well.
Both players. That would have been an extraordinary get from Fahey. That's brilliant. Pressure withstanding from Shenkman there.
Lewis Williams would have made that.
You made a couple in your match, didn't you?
That was more shit footwork.
Apologies for any bad language you might have heard there. Public service announcement. Yeah, Shenk's just judging that instinctively that it might have been dropping into the dead on. It's close. Tamba's so useful in this game. Rob looking to cover that. Rob looking to cover that grill shot down the line that Shenkman's been finding with unerring accuracy.
Not much you could do that.
There's another rotten bounce there. Got a chance for 6-3 here. This is quite a big turning point. Well, stay in that rally, actually, to be fair. Fahey there, deliberately not really going for the galleries. I think he thinks he's better off playing telling shots to try and get short chases than just being content with any chase. So even here, you see him forcing a lot. Oh, that's a quality shot. Had to get his feet in the right position. But eventually did. That ball was just getting away from him and he just took his foot off the accelerator. Probably hit that at 70-80% rather than fully unleashing to get it up and down. Very well judged. Don't expect anything less, obviously. Shenk's difficult to see the stream there. We can see Shenk's just trying to get a bit more grip on his shoes using the water fountain at the side of the court. Can get a bit slippery, this flagstone from the court here at Queens. Well, good pressure. Good guess initially from Shenkman to keep the rally alive. 4-5.
Keeps him at bay.
Fahey just one in arrears. It's a good shot. Had to be very accurate that shot into the corner, but he was.
Effective shot for both players.
So 30 love lead. What do you do now, Vaughan? Are you looking to hope. Go and you know, keep your foot on the pedal? Are you thinking chase?
Probably. I don't know. Yeah.
Always a chase. He's getting good results from this Wilson as well.
Deliberately going for the chases so far. He's shanked. Yeah. Skinny one down the line. Fahey there.
Did it stay very tight.
There is that chase. It's probably the serve Rob was looking for though. Grabbing that side. Yeah. Tough to volley those because of the spin imparted from the server. Players are much further to take it off the back wall. This is interesting there, Rob choosing not to hit that shot.
Ops for a chase two.
I think he's slightly frustrated himself he didn't go for that in the end. Wasn't quite tight to the wall. See on the replay here how acrobatic Shenkman has to be at the other end. It's a brilliant illustration of the footwork needed to always be in the right position. Lots of side to side movements, quick short movements, and even then very easy to come a cropper. Been an exhilarating match so far. Both players feeling the heat, toweling off. So here is the rest of the schedule for Wednesday. Today, obviously Thursday and Friday. Plenty of cracking matches there. Different players playing the doubles each day, obviously, which is good to see. Bobble there again.
Seems to be working. Chase two.
Moves this down pretty wide there. More than halfway over towards the main ball.
Yeah.
That's a good shot though. Beating chase two.
Slightly too short on that one.
That's fantastic. Beating chase two, 40-30 down. Your opponent would go 6-4 up. Fantastic confidence and ability. Yeah, elemental Fahey.
That's his trademark.
How important that was, and we're back on parity at 5-all.
Oh,
now Shenk's turn to redesign the court. Shenkman asking if it
has taken a bit of a beating this match.
Shenkman hoping for a bit of financial reward from our sponsors FLM for that shot. Slightly ruined their logo, unfortunately.
I think he's chuffed with that.
Yeah, feather in the cap for the target hitter. It's a brilliant volley on the run from Rob Fahey in the middle of that rally. Just gave him a bit more of a foothold.
points won, 37-36. Shows how tight it is.
Yeah.
That's a great shot.
A lovely shot. That's probably what Rob Shenkman's going to do more of. Keep moving about the court. Don't let it be static to wind up. Those forces. Who's your money on then? If you'd said 5-all.
4. I'm gonna have to stick to Fahey. I did predict 9-5, so still on.
Okay. Got any money on that one?
No money on that one. Not that confident.
No resident bookies in the house tonight. Not at Leamington.
Feel free to open one.
Yeah. Shanks up in this game, but a couple of, well, one tough chase to beat, the other one.
That's a great effort.
Didn't hit the dinkles call there, oh, he beat the chase, that's a fantastic shot from Rob. Getting the confidence to go for that. Oh, ooh. Another leave from Fahey that ends up in the dead on. That is potentially costly. Vaughan's 9-5 prediction no longer on.
Oh yeah.
Maybe the other way.
Say which, Rob.
Oh, came off. Shanks' reaction there is because both of those shots from Rob Fahey came off the very edge of the timbre. Pretty impossible to read those correctly every time.
Oof.
Great power in the back on there. Shenkman getting very tucked up there by the spin of the ball. Faster than his backhand volley. He thinks, yeah, well, I can do something with this. So he strives for more. It's a good sign in a way. Bit of an error there. Right, that allows.
You allowed him
Rob
in there.
Right.
At level again.
Three set shootout. Three game shootout. Here we go.
Very hard to call at the moment.
Feel if Fahey can get his nose in front of this game.
Yeah, he's yet to go in front, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, he dug it.
Just feel the pressure starting to turn. Very subtle, but... Shame. A few more comments to himself. Pleasing to Fahey, but just he's going about his business as he has done for the past however many years. Calmly, serenely, ruthlessly. Great volley. Great volley. Wouldn't have known that was coming down the back inside. Rob climbing. Again. Oh, what a fantastic rally.
Great rally.
Not much appreciation from the dead. Goodness me. What are they expecting? Fireworks. Boast from Rob Fahey, kind of into the middle of the court, and he just went wide with that grill attempt first up. So now,
yeah, he was making those earlier on in the set.
Yeah, but that's the sort of containing serve though that's going to time down. Going back to the point about Fahey does get his nose in front of this game, you feel he's such a good front runner, as he's proved. Year after year.
Crucial game.
In any setting. Usually talk about the crucial seventh game of a normal six game set, but it's 3-3. This is the sort of equivalent. Nine.
Crucial 13th.
Crucial 13th.
Don't hear that often.
Exactly. Unlucky for some. The last game once Shanks' tactic's going to be to try and beat this pace. Just misses. Last gallery there. Fahey moves 4-15 in front. Boast from Fahey, the volley. Boast from Fahey was going into Vinagara.
Very powerful.
Shenkman leaving that for a hazard chase. Finds himself behind for the first time in this match. Straight than he thought. Fahey hitting around the outside of it, so just kept it tight under the grill there. When it's going your way.
Momentum switches, you can definitely feel it.
Rob just asking what the pending chase was there. Fahey was keen to get to that, be good. No harm done though. actually Shanks' service points once percentage just come down slightly from 60 to 55.
Yeah, you can see it was going in.
Affecting the change of momentum. Both players playing this match with a smile on their face, though. It's good to see, even at the business end of this encounter. So, Fahey 30, love up. Can he make these two chases count? Yeah, first one negotiated. Has a chase beaten with a shot into the second gallery. Oh, but what a finish that is from Fahey.
Can't do much about that.
As sure as eggs is eggs, he turns up the pressure when he's most needed.
He's 8-6 leading.
8-6 in front.
The railroad volley.
Absolutely. Just in case we haven't had enough entertainment this game so far. Frustration there from Rob Fahey. Normally keeps the temperament very cool. Shenkman would be the more vocal one out of these two. Good shot. But Fahey did manage to put pressure back on. With a wide, nice wide backhand there. Cord. That's a good shot.
Done well to get that back out.
Yeah, that was a good shot. It was that first shot down the line. Down into the town, but he didn't overhit it. He was already running away from it, he didn't overhit it. That'd be pretty awkward for Fahey. They won the point as a result. Good bit of pressure. Can he make it 40-15 at the turn? Great guess. Yes, he can. That's very good play from Shanks. Not much appreciated from the dead on. Yeah, I'll be fair. Rob's boast day. Rob Fahey's boasted, he's seen it a lot in the World Championship, the last one he played at Prested against Cam, who would regularly serve bobbles.
Cool,
the,
replay.
The tighter they got to the back wall, the more he'd have to boast, and that boast was very close to the corner of winning gallery. So, 4-15. Shenkman leads 2 games behind.
Taking a bit of time to compose.
Yeah. That's unlucky. Losing the chase from the net cord there. Very happy to get a little breather by walking up the court and dealing with that ball. Saves one of those game points, can he save the other? Yeah, he can. Rob Shepard will find him in the very top inch or two of that 5 feet high, 5 foot high building net on the far side.
Brings that match point.
Okay, who's to within a point of victory here? Can he do it?
the tie at Waddle for the Shenkman henchmen and the Fey forces. So yeah, it's all to play for in this next doubles.
Absolutely.
Well, we'll be tuned in again at 8 o'clock, so
in a moment
there is
two.
No wait.
There's a match summary for you. Pretty tight throughout. Fahey just nudging most of those numbers, apart from the grills, obviously.
Yeah.
Yeah, great match. One all. All to play for.
Hello, my name is Sam Candy and I'm the advisor at FLM. FLM are proudly sponsoring the National League and we are really looking forward to the Super League in April, which is taking place over 4 days at Queen's Park. This short and sweet video is simply an introduction to what we do and how we do it. Specifically, how we help people in sport. So what is it that we actually do? Well, we help people be in the best possible financial position they can be. Specifically, we ensure that clients achieve their goals and aspirations through holistic and quality financial planning. We work with people long term to build a plan and importantly, stick to it. We also ensure to educate and improve understanding of the broader financial world to those who don't work in the industry. When it comes to understanding and education on finance, we feel the sports industry specifically is somewhat overlooked, where people have less possibly conversations on finances and there are typically no centralised wellbeing service that would otherwise be available in a classic 9-to-5 office setting. How people are paid, career options, length of career, as well as structure, employed, self-employed or through a limited company. These are all completely different for the sports industry. Very difficult to navigate through all of this and that's where we come in. As the key sponsor of the IRTPA's National League, I'm available to you to help. If you are interested in learning more, upskilling financially, getting a plan together to be in a better position, please do reach out. Thank you and looking forward to the Super League in April. Hello, my name is Sam Candy and I'm the advisor at FLM. FLM are proudly sponsoring the National League and we are really looking forward to the Super League in April, which is taking place over 4 days at Queen's Park. This short and sweet video is simply an introduction to what we do and how we do it. Specifically, how we help people in sport. So what is it that we actually do? Well, we help people be in the best possible financial position they can be. Specifically, we ensure that clients achieve their goals and aspirations through holistic and quality financial planning. We work with people long term to build a plan and importantly, stick to it. We also ensure to educate and improve understanding of the broader financial world and to those who don't work in the industry. When it comes to understanding and education on finance, we feel the sports industry specifically is somewhat overlooked, where people have less possibly conversations on finances, and there are typically no centralised wellbeing service that would otherwise be available in a classic 9-to-5 office setting. How people are paid, career options, length of career, as well as structure, employed, self-employed, or through a limited company. These are all completely different for the sports industry. Very difficult to navigate through all of this, and that's where we come. As the key sponsor of the ARTPA's National League, I'm available to you to help. If you are interested in learning more, upskilling financially, and getting a plan together to be in a better position, please do reach out. Thank you, and looking forward to the Super League in April.
Tell us when we're live. Tell us when we're live. Will you tell us when we're live? 10 seconds. It's not hard to be left. You're the expert. Good evening, this is the final match of the evening, the final rubber of this match, and the winner of this one takes the title. Sorry, takes the overall match, because this is worth 2 points. I've got with me Max Truman, who's the Junior World Champion and Amateur Doubles Champion currently, amongst many other titles. Good evening, Max.
Good evening.
Not so bad. So, this should be quite lively with two big hitters. How do you see it going?
I think Will and Nina will take it, to be honest. Might be a bit harsh to say, but probably Bertie being one of the sort of weaker players on the doubles court, on court at the moment. Got the other three are pretty.
That's probably not
pretty solid doubles players.
Not an unfair comment. And. Who have you got? What have you got going on tomorrow? What's the knockout?
Tomorrow, I'm on at 2. So the Mavericks are playing against.
So you're playing for the Mavericks?
I'm playing for the Mavericks. Ben Taylor Matthews, Mavericks against Robert Shenkman's Henchmen. And I'm playing singles against Nino at 2.
That'll be lively.
It'll be tough. A rematch of the British Open.
So the teams on this match are Shenkman's?
Shenkman's Henchmen and
the Fahey's
Forces.
So Bertie and Lewis are knocking up at the moment at the service end with the Fahey's. And the guys at the other end, the Mavericks, with you?
No.
Sorry.
They're the Henchmen.
Henchmen, yes.
Yeah.
You're playing them tomorrow.
Yeah, so we had a pretty good result today. Winning our first day 2-1.
How did you get on?
We lost our doubles, unfortunately, 9-7.
Pretty lively stuff there, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was pretty tight. I mean, I think it was 1-love, 1-all, 2-1, 2-all.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone went sort of two games ahead until the last two.
Yeah.
could have gone either way.
A win's a win.
Certainly.
It's always nice when your singles guys put you in a winning position before you play.
It makes it a lot easier. But yeah, I think it's just the added pressure, isn't it? So yeah, we sort of went on going. We didn't have the pressure of having to win. So.
And of course, Nino had a pretty good run with Henry Hammond in the Open.
He did. Yeah.
And Will's not a terrible doubles player, is he?
No, he's pretty good. I mean, haven't played with him for a long time.
Played against him a few times, though.
Played against him a few times. Played with him a few times. Yeah, he's pretty. I mean, I usually just stick him up at the top and let him unleash. Yeah, Will's had on the screen now, Will's career highlights, not bad. As a junior, he won pretty much everything he can.
Yep.
How old is he now? 20?
21. 21? Yeah, just turned 21.
Yeah, so...
A couple months ago.
I think this could be interesting with, I think, Nino mixing up his serves a lot.
Yeah, spending time with Chris Ronaldson, you end up developing a lot of different serves.
Hopefully Will can just sort of open up and...
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how they play. I think they'll probably start server up just to get warmed up, but
yeah.
I suspect the strongest combination...
You don't have much time to work it out there, do you, with these nine game
That's
sets?
That's it, yeah. I was going to ask you about that. What do you reckon on, first of all, having the team event type thing, including the pros, which is quite unusual, and the nine game sets?
Yeah, I mean, it's just different. I think we were all very excited coming into it, sort of having us as a few amateurs with all the pros. I think it's the first time that sort of we've had an opportunity to sort of play with them
and actually against them. And that last match showed what, you know, Robert Shenkman obviously is the best amateur in the country, but that was some pretty phenomenal stuff. And Rob only just got over the line at the end.
But yeah, I mean, for us, sort of, I mean, with the new Tampa Tour this season, we've got the opportunity to play the other pros sort of around the 1 to 15 bracket.
How are you getting on in that? How's that going?
It's pretty good. I've had a pretty good season so far. I think first one at Hollyport, I didn't get through the qualifiers. Will beat me in that. But then came to Petworth at the next one and got to the final. What was after Petworth? That was then Prested, where I got to the semi-final. And then got to the final in the last one at Leamington. So.
Right, looks like Lewis and Bertie are serving, and sounds like Darren Long is your marker.
Ben Taylor Matthews, I think.
Oh, Ben Taylor Matthews, I'll take it back.
Daz has stood next to us.
Yeah, okay, thanks for that, Max.
Yep, so final match of the day. Williams serving to Nino Marola.
So you've got two of the heaviest hitters in the game here, well, the heaviest. And Lewis can put some pace on the ball. Great return from Bertie. That'll settle his nerves a bit.
It's good pace from Marola. I think there's going to be a lot of that today, just nailing it at those galleries.
It's interesting, I was talking to Rob during the British Open, and he was saying there are only three or four players that actually play doubles differently. So looking at what Nino and Max will have done already, finding those angles to get chases, getting short chases in doubles is actually quite tricky.
Yeah. I think what's good with this sort of tournament as well, you have a lot of players playing with different people.
Yeah, so you don't get settled.
Yeah, I mean, Will and Nino's probably the first time they've been on court together. That's same true. Side and same as Bertie and Lou.
Lovely. So, Nino and Will are laying down some intent here.
Started off quick, firing them out.
We've got a fairly good crowd in the dead on here. We're up the top with a few of the players. And there's a lot of people in the middle gallery looking from behind the glass.
Got Prince Edward in attendance as well, don't we?
He's been here, yes. Will stop straight away.
Great
going up the main wall, Tim Chisholm-like. Or you could call it.
It's great. That's a great way to just cut off the
Chizier-esque. So what does that do specifically? That was going up that main wall.
I mean, it just. I think a lot of the receivers always think it's just the backhand players that go up, which obviously cuts down the backhand corner. But as soon as like they sort of don't expect.
When you say backhand, do you mean the lefties?
Yeah. But like Will there, he's moved up to what, six?
Yeah.
To last gallery. And it just any cut volley is going to be cut off on the volley, which just completely opens up the hazard galleries and just sort of nailing it down the line as well.
And I suspect it probably cuts out any sort of main wall as well.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
I mean,
when you're that far up, the main wall's sort of
gone.
Yeah, it's gone because they're going to be volleying it before it reaches the main wall. So it's pretty fast paced.
This is actually working quite well. Bertie's holding his own. Yeah,
Bertie, yeah, he's just a very defensive player, I think, which obviously works well on a doubles court. And it's his home court, so he knows it inside out.
Yeah, he'll be serving well here.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there, Will didn't go up, and actually that would have been
beneficial.
Yeah,
he was sort of stuck in the middle there, sort of at 3 and 4.
No man's land.
Yeah, interesting that they've started Will at the back. Maybe they're just.
Yeah. We'll see how that carries on.
Yeah.
See, winning a quick first game helps.
Yeah.
So, of course, the other thing, though, as Rob christened them, Chizier, so Tim Chisholm and Cam Riviere, Tim going up that main wall isn't an issue if the ball gets past him, so obviously it's not going to be because Camden's very good at covering the rest of it.
It's not an issue when Cam's like.
But I suspect Nino's pretty quick.
Yeah.
That was a short chase, though.
Another chase a yard. So it could be unleashed again.
So that's one game all. We'll have the score coming soon.
Crowd are calling for pace. Chases already. A couple of 1 yarders, sort of 3 and 4s.
Great volley. Bertie's coming out strong here. There we go, we've got the scoreboard. Thank you, Ben. It's ironic, he's doing it to Lewis, because Lewis is pretty good at it too.
Yeah.
Yes, I was at Petworth yesterday looking at the court.
Yeah.
And you sort of forget it's got the widest dead on.
That's
the game.
Stupid.
And it's only 3 foot to the main wall.
Yeah.
Whereas most courts are 4, so you've actually got foot of width.
Yeah, most courts you're sort of hitting the main wall on. Probably 4 yards up on the wall. And Petworth, you can go down sort of two.
Yeah.
I mean,
bites in.
Playing Lewis Gordon there, the home pro, is very tough.
Anton, yeah.
I mean, yeah. Just that maple was such a good choice. And the net is also lowered.
Yes, it is. It's 3 inches lower, four inches yeah. lower. Yeah.
Apparently you're right. That's because the founder of the court, whoever built it, liked hitting it down the line. So he made the court to suit him.
One of the things in doubles, of course, is if you do hit the tandem, there's someone else to hit the ball. So it's not always the best tactic.
Yeah. And there's always someone stood in the grill watching it, so they sort of know pretty much every time whether it's going to hit or not.
Should have left that. Yeah, it's working as well. He puts a little bit of twist on that as he hits it, so it actually not only goes a bit deeper, but actually kicks off the wall a bit. There it goes. So he's put a little bit of back spin on that.
Yeah, I think it's inside. a bit sort of underarm twisty.
Yeah, but coming inside out.
Yeah.
Is a neutral court. I mean, people like Bryn do a very good drop, but doesn't.
Giraffe's good serve. Yeah. It's got to be the only problem with the giraffe is it's got to be perfect.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they're just going to step up and volley it short, or they're going to. What's going on the back pen now? So they can force it.
Yes, in the first match, I think it was Levi was serving some flush.
Yeah.
Flush giraffe.
Yeah.
But of course, also, it's one of those serves where if you do get it wrong, you're just placing yourself up to physical abuse.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you consider good serving courts?
I like serving at Tucks, to be honest.
Yeah, good penthouse.
Yeah, the good penthouse.
Quite steep.
I mean, to be fair, C court as a home court, I still find it quite tough to serve. I mean, obviously I serve so much there anyway that it's not awful, but I wouldn't say there's a serve at C court that actually stands out.
Yeah. So Lewis did very well to leave that ball just went on the penthouse, but then got Brian lucky with a bounce.
Yeah.
So it died on 3 yards.
Bring it back to juice, big game.
Very.
Start of this match. Just
he actually went quite fat with that one and it came into Lewis's body, which is not a bad tactic. He hit it about last gallery. Bertie has every right to be smiling after those three, especially that last one that was coming at pace. Unlucky. That was going back to Bertie, actually, wasn't it?
Yeah.
He was ready for it.
Good pace. It's pretty hard.
3-1.
Bertie got a lot of home support tonight.
Yeah. His dad's actually standing alongside
us. Standing there.
Bertie's very sensibly backing off there. Just give them a second gallery. Yeah. Well, we talked about that on the car on the way up, didn't we?
Yeah. Don't want to get caught with a ball in your face up now.
No. Bit of turn on that from Nina.
Players using tamper string, two players using flash away.
Nice. Equitable.
Yeah. No, I'm currently using half and half.
What is that?
I think with the ash away you can get it a bit tighter, so I'm going ash away for the mains.
Right.
Just to crank it up and then a bit of tamper.
So would that also potentially give you a bit more grip because it's a bit rougher, or doesn't it make a difference?
I don't think it makes a difference, to be honest. I just prefer the look of timbre, a bit of colour.
Yeah. And also you see exactly where you centre and averagely hit the ball.
Yeah.
It's quite
Cam's racket, it's like a 2p pence.
Two pence piece in the middle, yeah. And also you see where it centres. I noticed some of them are 3 or 4 inches higher than others.
Yeah.
But they're consistent.
Yeah. Well, I managed to break 2 strings at once yesterday. First time ever, I think.
The record I've seen on that was Luke Danby managed to break a string in 5 different places with 1 shot.
Yeah,
and one of those strings was broken in 2 places and was being held in by the other strings.
Yeah.
If you, and you faced a few of Luke's bullets, I'm sure.
Yeah, I have, yeah. I think we played an exhibition probably 4 or 5 weeks ago. And I've served one at the sidewall in, and he's just slap volleyed it down the line at me. And it was going straight at my nose.
You just got a duck.
And I just, yeah, had to duck.
Yeah, yeah. Don't even think about hitting it. He once hit one in the lunchtime doubles at Seaport, nothing. And I did a periscope and I heard a crack. And I wonder what it was, thought the racket wasn't cracked. A few points later, I found that he'd actually pulled the strings through the throat of the racket.
Yeah.
And he's one that generates that pace without any backswing.
Yeah.
Still fun to play against, though.
Oh, yeah.
Love it.
Attempt a hot dog there from Lewis, but it nicked.
Just to go 4-1 up in the game.
Yeah. At the moment, your prediction's looking okay, but you can never tell.
4-1.
So Will playing back seems to be working.
It's kind of the last.
So I also noticed Nino is on the first return is staying back at three or four yards. Why is that?
Off there, it just doesn't expose the other player at the back. Going up too far too early gives a receiver. Play, receive and serve, just gives them the option to hit that flat post in behind the player.
Oh, that was class. Will does have a knack of doing that. Does it also take away from that gallery player as a target?
Yeah. I think with the volley a bit further back, it gives them more time to actually be able to play it. So, just less risk of racket errors, really.
Into a hot rally.
Change of angle.
That was really good rally. Play from Lewis.
Yeah, Lou likes to turn on those balls.
So did you notice that one of those shots hit the net quite hard? What actually happens to the ball when it hits the hard?
Just completely changes the spin.
So it becomes top spin?
Becomes top spin. If it hits the floor and then the back wall, it usually will. Probably the 75% of the chance of the time will just go straight over your head.
Yeah. So Nino actually read that.
He read that.
Stepped
well,
up the court.
Yeah.
And then he nicked, and Lewis still managed to win the rally, which was quite impressive.
Yeah. It's just, especially out here at Queens, you got to attack.
Yeah.
Such a bounce. It's a pretty bouncy court. Well, it's a neutral court, but it's pretty bouncy. So rallies can just go on and on, so especially in doubles.
Am I right in thinking Lewis is a bit like the rackets players? He's very good at being very late on a swing.
Yeah.
So he's able to get stuff that doesn't bounce very high.
Yeah.
That's what he did on that.
Yeah. He's got pretty impressive hands.
As you said, that's pretty impressive.
It's taken very late. Yeah.
So interestingly, the Petworth boys, Nick Wood, Chris Bray, Tom Turak, and even those now, are also very good at boasting the main walls against the wall, back against the wall.
Is that
because of the wide penthouse? Wide dead on?
Yeah, I think because, I mean, the main wall's like the majority of return serves at Petworth is a main wall.
Yeah.
So I think they just sort of learn that it's better to just punch it back where it's came from, get out of trouble.
Yeah. And it also brings it in an angle.
Especially when you're in the corner, you sort of punch it back into main wall, so it's looping back to them, so it gives you time to get back to the middle. Reset.
That was a great shot from Will.
I mean, Will's just got so much power there that he can get out of trouble.
And the harder you hit those, the more spin comes on them, so they tend to straighten up as they come into the corner.
It's tough when it's spinning like that in the corners. If it hits floor, then sidewall, you can never read it properly.
It actually is something those of us from C court actually have to do a lot, because the back wall takes cut.
And you want to get that. You want to get in there early and stop it from hitting the back wall. Points to go.
5-1 over halfway. It seems closer than the score line. Rallies.
Yeah, they're good rallies. Just missed the dead on, and that's the game. 5-1. Yeah, I wouldn't say there's any. No, I wouldn't say any of the boys on there are playing badly at all.
I think the current servers seem to have been winning the deuce games as well, which always makes a difference. Yeah. It's a bit like the famous 40 alls in handicap.
Yep.
I think Nino would have struggled with that one.
Yeah, I think that was going
behind him.
Nick.
Yeah,
but he would have nicked and rolled or hit floor and spun behind him.
Yeah, I think he would have done. I was just going to say that he puts a very heavy ball, so this heavy means it's got pace and spin. So there's a lot of cut on that, so you can't let it go to the back wall at all. Will did well with both of those.
Pace and spin is a deadly combination.
Oh.
Middled it.
It's pretty full dead on in there tonight.
Yeah.
For Queens.
Yeah, they had the T&RA benefactors drinks this evening, which was a very nice thing for them to do on the first night of the FLM Super League. So where did the idea for the Super League come from?
I think it was partly because last season the Div 1 in National League, so sort of 0 to 10 handicaps. It was just a bit of a mix. I mean, I played in probably 5 of the matches last season. I think I just filled in for people, and I think I played for 5 different clubs. I'm pretty sure I played for a different club every time I played. I think it just ended up being sort of like pros from other clubs and just, well, the pros of their home club.
So just have to say, William Flint just played an amazing rally. Finished it off well. So where did the concept of this setup come from?
Bente Matthews was the one to suggest it at first. I've just had dinner with him, and he's claimed he hasn't stolen it from.
It is slightly different format.
It is slightly different format, but it is pretty much carbon copy. But even so, I mean, I think it's great. So far, I mean, it's only been the first day so far, but it's been some very competitive tennis.
Oh, all the matches have been really close.
Yeah,
you know, even ones that people were calling as being quite easy.
Yeah,
have, I mean, ended up being 9-7s and 9-8s.
Pretty much the top 16 players in the UK all competing.
That's good.
Obviously, you've got the four big boys at the top. It's the team captains and them.
Shanks will like that comment.
Shanks will like that. But he's definitely getting that. Yeah, I mean, Shanks is definitely getting there now.
Yeah.
I think he's...
His performance just now against Rob was...
In the last year or so, he's definitely cemented himself getting... I mean, he's just made a top 10 in the world as well.
Sorry, Ben just sorting our sound out there. We've got a loose wire, but we think we sorted it. Thank you, Ben. So, yeah, I think Shanks, he had a really good run against Kieran and...
Yeah.
In Australia a couple of times.
It's always tough going and playing Kieran in Oz. It's always going to be tough.
This is very easy to think that these people that aren't travelling as much because they've got, you know, family life and stuff, but
yeah.
Kieran is still playing pretty fit and he's playing to a decent plus handicap.
Yeah.
So even taking one set off is a decent effort on his own court.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, Shenkman's results in the last few Opens have been...
Yeah,
he's getting closer and closer to those semis.
Calling from Lewis here.
Left that forehand side open though.
Still in last gallery.
That's great hands.
Oh, he was unlucky there.
Use it.
Great hands from Nino down on that tower.
Yeah. Yes, Nino had a great open, both singles and doubles.
He did. Beat me in the qualies to get into the main draw.
Well, obviously that makes him a superstar, just with that one result.
Exactly. No, I'm joking. He played very well, actually.
He had a great run against Camden in the first round. Or Camden's first round, sorry. He won his first round himself.
Did he get a set off Camden?
Yeah, he got a set off Camden. And, yeah, and,
set.
And he and Henman. Henman Jr. got the first set off.
Yeah.
Off Tim and Cam. Not many people do that. Oh, use the bando. To get the ball to bounce off a 2-inch bando like that is quite impressive. I'm sure he played for it.
A bit more luck than judgement that one, but everyone needs a bit of it at some points.
It's funny, isn't it? The people that are winning tend to see their more luck.
Yeah. That's a great demo, PK.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Good return from Buddy. Yeah. Buddy doing well here. They've got the game point. They really need this.
Switch Nino to the back now. Bit of a change up. To go to get their second game.
Oh, probably would have taken the chase there.
Watch that force from in the Hazards.
They're winning more points. Yeah, is it called a force?
Got to have Bertie turning in then, no. Though. He can actually.
Sorry, Bertie.
To be fair, he can actually hit it quite hard.
He's talked a few today.
Yeah, he can actually hit it quite hard.
Well, you all. I mean, people talk about the guys being a bit hardest, but. The rest of you are still up to 100 miles an hour and plus.
Yes, pretty lethal.
And ironically, you very rarely get direct hits, but if it hits the edge of the tamper or your racket, you might end up wearing it.
I mean, I've had a couple of direct hits from Will, and it leaves a nice bruise for a good week or two.
As long as it's on your legs or your torso, that's fine.
But, I mean, in DC, last summer for the Van Allen, Will absolutely nailed Freddie Bristow up at the tamper inside of the leg. It was just like, I mean, absolutely nailed him.
Did Will win the match against Freddie?
Probably not.
Freddie's actually improved. Freddie's a real deal.
He's playing very well at Reader's and he's also playing very well in the rackets.
Winning good stuff in the rackets, yeah. And he
got to the British Open final in the rackets.
Yep.
And Corston took the first game, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. And also in the
national super national league in New York last week. He had some very good wins, especially doubles.
Yeah, he's a very solid doubles player. His volleying is pretty good.
That's what a get volley from Lewis.
Oh.
Yes, oh. And the other, the surprise combo in the doubles was Freddie with Barney. Barney Tanfield. Barney's always been a good doubles player anyway.
Barney's pretty good.
But those two played very intelligently and got some very good results.
Yeah, I mean, that partnership's pretty good with Barney sort of just unloading his pace and then Freddie just popping up at the back.
There we have it, 2 games for 6. Keep it up. Keeping in the game, 7-1 would have been a bit hard.
Yeah, I think the Shenkman Henchmen need to win this game to sort of stop the momentum from snowballing.
Yeah, stick him with these wide.
Stick him with a high drop. Short though, which is going to be eaten up.
Yeah, it's done a couple of demis, which seems to work quite well.
That's the problem with the high drop, isn't it? High drop and draft, they just have to be perfect. He's short again.
This one's a bit better.
It's a bit better, but it's still...
Yeah.
I think at Queens, the draft works better than the high drop.
So what's the difference in... Oh! Oh, Bertie! That's got a big smile on his face. He doesn't mind what happens now. I'm sure there'll be a replay of that one, won't there, Ben? That was class.
Yeah, so anyway, the high drop is sort of what Lou's just done there. He's sort of come round the ball.
Is it hitting the main ball?
No, it's more just sort of hitting that penthouse and dropping down, hopefully coming flush.
So it's a slower serve.
Oh, well.
Class from Will there, half pace, but straight over Lewis's shoulder.
And then you obviously got the giraffe, which is more of a sort of underarm twist up into the air, which is aiming to hit the side wall to then rip down the penthouse
along the back
to come
wall.
Flush.
Yeah. So the same thing. Levi was hitting some good ones earlier.
Yeah.
Just one bounce on the back penthouse.
Exactly. I just think the high drop here, just because the penthouse is quite slippery anyway.
Yeah. It's looking very clean. It is looking very clean though.
It is
so
very clean, but
the court is in good condition.
Yeah, I think they just need to. Yeah, just they need to sort of land it in a less than a metre diameter get it perfect. So compared to giraffe, where you can sort of aim at a sort of 2 to 3 metre like sort of window on the wall, makes it a bit easier. And it's also coming down faster with a bit of spin. Yeah, I know, like a Petworth, the high drop's very good.
Yeah, they've got plenty of height there. It's probably a little bit higher than this.
Yeah. And then obviously, it's a C-core, it's impossible to practice high serve.
You have to thread it through three beams. And even then, you're going out. Not good as high as even this court.
No. It's like a medium high serve.
C-core does have lots of other serves that work very well.
Oh, yeah. Go to Paris and launch up.
Yeah. Oh, Paris is over 50 foot. Paris is silly.
That's huge.
Well, that's very bouncy. Yeah.
Oh. Lewis up there.
Managed to come short of Will there. That was, if that was deliberate, that was a very clever shot. There you go. Recognition from Nino. Angles here, both teams slowed it down. We've had everything. Oh.
Too early, Will.
It was.
Going back down the line.
That was for 7-2, so the other end needed to win it.
Looking like he's going to hit a full PK into a demi.
He's never known to serve the same serve twice in a set. Topspin on that one, maybe a bit too much. Yeah, back ball. How did that stay?
He's back.
Third in the yard.
Which could get.
To be fair, I think he was going to go and pick up that ball. That's a bit long.
Skids up into that roof. Doing a bit of Tim and Cam.
Yep.
Staying to the middle and then splitting.
I'm not sure it's deliberate though.
Definitely.
I think they were both going to the galleries and suddenly realised one of them had to stay at the back of the force.
They've done well, they've won the point from that.
So that's advantage.
7-2 up.
I think I'm most disappointed about it. You had lunch without, dinner without me.
Well, luckily I walked into the bar just as they were ordering, so I thought I'd get in on it. Chicken Caesar salad, I went healthy tonight.
Oh, are we going to be doing the Donald run on the way home for well? That wasn't coming back.
Get up there.
So there we have 7-2. Two games to the match. So
looks like the henchmen are going to take this one. Yep. 2-1 overall. But it's not done yet.
Oh, great get from Bertie.
Proper doubles. Proper doubles.
Are you smiling again? You can't stop the boy from smiling.
The last sort of 6 months, Bertie's actually learned how to play doubles.
It looks like that. That way, yeah. It's quite impressive.
We had the Seacourt Club chance. Will and myself played James Medler and Bertie. Very good. Probably one of the most enjoyable doubles matches I've played, actually.
Did you win it?
We did win it just.
I was away for that, so you were lucky.
Yeah, it was just. But yeah, it was, I mean, it was pretty fun. I think it was good. Two and a half hours.
That's a proper match for three setter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, compared to our amateur semi final against Shenkman.
4 hours?
It was just over 4 hours.
That was impressive. Was,
hard work.
That was proper. Yeah,
that was hard work.
Good result though.
Yeah, I think that's probably one of our best.
Was that you and James?
Myself and James Medley, yeah. Probably one of the best wins in our tennis careers so far.
So James didn't sort of smiling for a week, so I suspect he was quite pleased.
He was very pleased.
You know, just getting started well in this game, now they've got chase 3. That's too long. Good leave there for Willie, went up there to give Birdie something to aim at. That's a great get from Lewis. So funny you should mention the Tamba. Peter Dawes, the head pro at Seacourt for 30 years, always used to say to people, one rule from the service, Tamba, Tamba, Tamba. It's your friend. Great backhand from Nina.
Nice.
Nice being at the backhand makes that possible, doesn't it?
Yeah. Tell you what, Bertie is actually, he is very good at that down the line.
Yep.
Down the line course, that's what I've found. Playing him at singles,
yeah.
If you serve in that railroad and it's not tight, he will just
pump it down,
float that down the line.
Oh, float it? It's, so not the power and stuff like that?
Yeah, it's not, I mean, it's going in dead on most of the time.
Okay.
He sort of takes 25% off it and it's going in most of the time.
But that's what, you know.
I mean, you'd usually get to it. but you rarely actually get.
Can't do much with it. Yeah, something to be said for something James Medlow does very well, the sort of two-thirds pace main ball that you just play in a way that they can't even get to.
Yeah.
Great pick-up.
Oh!
Really want a replay. I believe that's what the youngsters call a sick shot.
Use it.
It wasn't the first one in the rally, but it's world class. Oh, great pick up.
What are they doing? Oh, they've both put them off so much.
They're both going to them. He's done it again.
Plan worse than six to protect those galleries.
See? I know. Better than half a yard.
So jammy.
Nino and Will both go to the same place again.
And then split in at the last second. May have put Lou off now.
It was deliberate, it's a great tactic.
Oh, we'll slow it.
Higher!
So that was a point for 8-2.
To juice after that long rally. It's a long bubble that's going to be eaten up.
Oh, worse than last.
Worse than last.
Won't mind that.
All up.
That's a better four. So actually, the slap down the middle in doubles.
Yeah.
Is that a good tactic?
Pretty good shot, yeah.
Does it work at all levels or all?
To a point, I think. I think it depends if you've got the volley sort of back at 2 and 3 to 4 yards, they might be able to get it. Just volley it or half volley it on their forehand side.
Yeah, to be fair, I think Bertie was up at sort of 5 and 6 there,
yeah,
so he got passing
him
too late for Lewis on the backhand.
Yeah. Worse than last. Can they find them? Railroad. Two bouncer.
Good railroad. That was a last finish.
Great shot.
This game's really easy, really, isn't it? When you get those shots.
It's easier with your middle.
Slightly loose serve. Good get from Lewis.
Where's it going to go?
Place of Tampa.
That's a good whip.
Lewis was there as well. So we've got 8-2. Yeah, so 40 points to 29 doesn't seem like 8-2. So this is a slightly unfair scoreline for the receivers.
Yeah, I think most of the game's been pretty close. But that's what it shows that. So, stay.
No, they put slopey. When they did the new windows a few years ago, they put slopey window ledge.
Yeah, we had a microphone get hit and fall down earlier.
Yes, saw that.
Nearly landed on my head.
Yeah, we heard it as well as seeing it.
Yeah, surprised. It's dropped from where we are now straight down onto the penthouse. Pretty heavy as well.
That's a great serve. Oh, that was unlucky. That would have been
all up. He's nearly gone up. It's just he's got so much strength back here. It's just
fat again, that fat both end, he puts so much side check on that, doesn't he? Yeah. It just bites the ball.
Yeah, I played him at Leamington a few weeks ago and he does it.
He's pretty good there, isn't he?
Yeah, I mean, that main ball just
again.
His volley puts so much work on it, does something different every time. Very annoying.
As you said earlier, he's got hands that this is something which most people can't see happen.
He has a very big swing, big back swing. That's a
great pickup.
Nail it.
So we're carrying on. Not done bad on schedule play. The first match actually took up the whole of the spare hour in between the matches.
Yeah, between Neil Macca
and Bryn and Ben.
Yeah, Bryn and Ben had pretty long one as well.
And your doubles wasn't sure. Oh, that's unlucky for Lewis. Yeah.
No, I think on my watch it said we were on for about 80 minutes, including warm up.
Okay, so all of the matches were basically now 20 minutes.
Pretty much an hour, yeah. We're still, what time is it now? 5 to 9.
Yeah, a 9-game set nominally is 45 minutes. But for the top players, the lap rallies are going to be longer. Yeah. So.
Fairly love. Two love. Two henchmen. Get this point and bring up three or four matches.
I'll be tough there for Bertie.
It's down.
Went a bit fat.
Look down to me.
Mark is always right. Especially when it's Ben.
Yeah, you don't want to get an argument with him.
That's a great handsome move. Using the ball. And again. Winning gallery.
Hi.
Which is fine. TC special top spin winning gallery.
As the Aussies say, a hazard is as good as a point.
That came from Paul Tabley, actually. Who you've probably never met, but
a
bit of a legend. He's a legend, Aussie. He lived in the UK for. So, we have 2 match points with a great backhand drive.
It's like a football crowd in here.
Yes, but Paul Tabley ran Hollyport when it was known as a popular tennis court. So 5 o'clock every day everyone would turn up and have a drink and a game of tennis. Before my tennis days, but I already knew Tabs, so bit of a rock star.
That brings up match point for the henchmen, Shenkman's henchmen.
Let's see what Bertie can pull out of the bag with the serve.
The hazard to chase of the round. It's better than second. I was going to say worse than that, but it's better than count. We're going to do high back wall. Watch your heads. Gather.
Oh. Touched it.
He touched it.
He did touch it.
Controversial. Anyway, that is game and the match. 9 games to 3 for the henchmen. That's a 2-1 win for them on the day. Bring them level with the Matthews Mavericks after day one.
So the FLM Super League continues at
2 o'clock tomorrow with myself against Nino Marola, Mavericks against the Henchmen.
And we will see you back here tomorrow. Thank you everyone for watching. And we will say good night to you now. And thank you to Ben for his streaming and with his team as well. Even though he never likes being singled out, he's sitting up here with a smile on his face. Thank you everyone. Good night.